above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall, you thought of me above all. Laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above
all. Amen. That was beautiful. Music, such a powerful tool for worship. And to be blessed with a beautiful voice and a humble heart is also a blessing. And in addition to all that, he also does. And so there's some nice landscaping. Of course, we have a few others in the room here. I don't know if they want their names to be mentioned or not, but we asked them to come up with a name for themselves. The all of the people who are working on the landscaping out there, and somebody said, call us the diggers, you know. But I think that the gardening angels sounds really good too, because I think landscaping is a work, is an act of worship, just like singing is, and giving and communion and so forth. And so thank you all for your gifts and for your contributions to worship here at First Christian Church of Atlanta. There's so much more than just preaching. And you all are a part of the total picture, and I appreciate that, as well as the other singers, Diane and Robert, and our wizards behind the camera and in the sound booth and so forth. So thank you for that. I have this tendency from time to time to get these crazy ideas, and one crazy idea I had was I want to do a sermon series called Extraordinary Acts of Faith. And when I say things like extraordinary acts, I don't know what you think of, but I think of people like walking on a tightrope between two tall buildings, you know, or jumping off a cliff or whatever. Because that's, I guess, kind of what we think of in terms of extraordinary acts or extraordinary feats. But actually, that's not at all what I had in mind with this series of messages. Instead, what I want to talk about is what makes being a Christian a little bit different, maybe a little bit more intense, a little bit more, I don't know what the right word is here, than the average person. And I don't mean to sound elitist, but what is it that is called upon us to do? What are we required to do that is virtuous, that is kind of above and beyond what is normally expected of people? And so the first message that I spoke about was Sabbath, you know, and the main point there was when God had called the children of Israel out of Egypt, out of 400 plus years of slavery, he told them to rest. And you can imagine not only these Israelites who had not known rest for all those centuries, how counterintuitive it might be to just stop working and rest. You can also imagine that, you know, people try to estimate how many people there were. On the low side, 600,000. On the high side, 1.5 million people. How do you feed that many people in the Sinai Desert? And if you take a day off from trying to collect food and water, how does that affect your survival chances? But God said, I will provide you rest. And so there is an aspect of that life that is carried on into the New Testament, that believers on the first day of the week would set aside their work and set aside their business and set aside everything that they do and rest. And part of that rest includes worship. And I do hope and pray that you find worship to be restful and uplifting and so forth. The second one was giving. In the Old Testament, God gave the people of Israel the tithe. And that tithe was basically a tax on the 11 tribes that were not priests. And the 11 tribes that were not priests were to take from their produce of grain or of fruits and vegetables or of meat, dairy, and so forth, and share that with the Levites who were the priests. And as you recall, the Levites were not given an allotment of land because their job was to stand between the people of Israel and God, and they were the priesthood, and therefore there was a tithe. So in the New Testament, we have a little different picture, but one thing is very clear. Paul believed that churches should care for one another. And so he went throughout the churches that he had started in Asia Minor and in Greece and on the islands there, and he collected an offering for them to carry back with him to Jerusalem for the believers in Jerusalem who were being persecuted and were marginalized in society. And of course, when he did, he made an offering in the temple and he was arrested and carried off to Rome, where he eventually, according to tradition, was beheaded. So those at first may not seem like extraordinary acts of faith. Taking a day off to us doesn't seem to be quite such a sacrifice. Giving a little bit from our income to the church or to the work of the church may or may not seem like much of a sacrifice until we realize that these are counterintuitive and they're countercultural. When we look at the economic mindset that rules our society, the idea of not working on Sunday like a restaurant, not being open, you're losing all this income. The idea that we're not out there trying to bring down our debt to income ratio. But you know, we have to take that time to rest, and we have to take that time to be with God. So it is extraordinary, because a lot of times people think, that's just a little crazy that you would do that. Today's topic, I think, is a little bit more obviously extraordinary, because as you saw the slide there, the topic today is agape. I'm hoping and trusting that you know that word, but we're going to go through it just in case. I could have said love. Why didn't I just say love? Anybody have a guess on that one? Multiple definitions. We use the word love to mean a number of different things in English, of course, and these are very well known, the Greek words that are often used. Everybody knows them probably, but I'll go through them just for fun. But in English, when we say, you know, I look at my wife and say, I love you. And then I love hamburgers. You know, I love watching Star Trek, whatever. You certainly hope that there's a degree of difference between those, right? Okay. And so anybody here able to rattle off the different words that we get from the Greek language for love? Yes, sir. Ken? Okay, it's fine. Agape is the highest. You got it. Uh-huh. Right. Mm-hmm. Eros. Yeah. Brotherly love. Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. And so phileo, or brotherly love. Eros, for erotic love, which, you know, of course, in our society, that only, you know, that kind of takes a vulgar turn. But it's not necessarily, pornography or whatever. Eros is the love that is shared between two people who are in a deep and loving and intimate relationship. And then storge, which is the love of a parent for a child. This being Father's Day, it's an appropriate time to talk about the parental love that we have for our children. And of course, agape. This is a word which I fear that sometimes we use it so much that we kind of lose its value. And so it's good to remind ourselves of what agape means. And agape is, of course, a word that comes from the Greek language that is used exclusively of God and God's love for humanity, and hopefully for humanity's love in return to God. It is stronger than eros. It is stronger than storge. It is stronger than phileo. Let me tell you why. We talk about brotherly love. There's a key there. It's brotherly, sisterly love. We love people who are like us. It's easy to love people who are like us. We share things in common. Maybe we're of the same ethnicity. Or maybe we're of the same language group or the same culture. Or maybe we come from the same parents. Or we come from the same family line. It's easy to love people like us. It's easy, I'm going to say this and laugh, but it's easy to love our own children. And for those of us who have children, we also know that sometimes it's really not easy to love our own children. Yeah. It's easier to love my children than to love someone else's children. And so on. But what is agape love? Agape love is a love for that person that I may not like. It's a love for someone who isn't like me. It's a love for somebody who may seem, by all earthly standards, unlovable. We'll talk more about that in just a minute. But I think for the discussion of agape love, I have picked what I consider to be the most difficult passage in the Bible. Now, it may not be the most difficult one for you, but it is, in my mind, the most difficult passage in the Bible. And before I even go into that, I want to mention a couple of other things. One is that in this passage, Jesus refers to God as your heavenly Father. So, Father's Day, passage with God being referred to as your heavenly Father. And then, I'm going to add a little psychology to this, if I may. He adds to that what I would call an impossible demand. Now, you don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to admit this. But have any of you ever had a father who placed what you thought was an impossible demand on you? Okay, at least we have some people who think so. Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about why we need impossible demands. I remember that when Ann's father died about 8 years ago, her sister was, you know, I guess they were all sort of talking about and reminiscing about the father, and her sister was talking about how he would just go ballistic if their gas gauge in their car went below halfway. And I'm not talking about his gas gauge, I'm talking about his daughter's gas gauge, you know. And the same way, right? When you were growing up, he would just, you know, if it's half full, go get gas, you know. And he was very, very insistent upon that. And, you know, and I guess they were kind of looking at that like overbearing, mean-spirited. You know, why, you know, it's okay. We can go down to a quarter of a tank of gas. There's gas stations everywhere. But I reflected upon that as a father. And I remember how overprotective I was of my children when they were little. And so it occurred to me that what he was doing, in case you haven't already guessed, is he's making sure that they're okay, right? He's making sure that they're very mindful. It's a scary thing for anybody to run out of gas in Atlanta, right? And so, what do we fathers do? Better make sure you get gas, you know? You know, every time I get in the car, Ann gets in there with, what does she do? Just looks over at that gas gauge, right? Yeah, know how to change a flat tire, right? And that's something that you taught your daughters how to do, right? Yeah, absolutely. It's scary. And so sometimes this is how fathers are. We have these impossible demands. But when we talk about a father, especially as a pastor, when I talk about fathers in general, and I don't really know what your experience was with your father, and I don't know, for those who are watching online, what your experiences were like, and I know it's very dangerous to just simply refer to God as Father and leave it without explaining, because there are some people who have had, you know, unspeakably horrible relationships with their fathers. And so when we refer to God as Father, one thing we really need to make clear is that we do not use our earthly fathers to meditate on our heavenly Father. It's the other way around. We judge our earthly fathers on the basis of our heavenly Father. Does that make sense? And that in itself is, in some ways, an impossible demand. Why do impossible demands exist? Or do they exist to frustrate us, to make us feel despair? I don't think so. I think an impossible demand is a goal that pushes us beyond our comfort zones. It pushes us a little further than we may push ourselves. Sometimes a parent, and I'll say mothers too, or aunts and uncles and godfathers and godmothers and so forth, sometimes we see potential in a child that they don't see themselves. And sometimes we want to kind of nudge them along. We know that we should reach for some goals, but we don't always have the willpower, so we need someone a little bit higher up than we are to sort of enforce those goals and sort of nudge us in those directions. To me, an impossible demand is a goal that we should pursue, but we ourselves may not pursue it unless someone else puts it upon us. You know, think about that child who starts taking piano lessons at a very young age. Many children at a very young age don't want to necessarily take piano lessons, but certainly all the hours of practicing and the discipline that involves, maybe they don't really understand or appreciate that value. But if you wait until they're old enough to understand and appreciate that value, guess what? It's too late. So that's what I believe about an impossible demand. I know there are people who have impossible demands and they are just impossible to deal with. I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about those loving demands that push us and nudge us to where we should be and where we may not be. Can love be commanded? That's another thing. Can God command us to love? And the answer, in my opinion, is yes, because God expects us to be like Him. Agape love is not like the love that's described in movies and television where, you know, I was in love with her, I fell in love with her, and then I fell out of love with her. You know, he loved me, and then he stopped loving me. Those are, you know, maybe forms of love. But the kind of love that agape is has nothing to do with how we feel. It has nothing to do with the mood that I'm in or the quality of my digestive process. Love, like agape love, is a habit. It is a love that is directed towards others, regardless of who they are and regardless of how different they are from me. So let's take just a minute to look at our passage again and kind of break it down bit by bit. The first verse, which is Matthew 5, verse 43, says the following. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Now, love your neighbor as yourself goes all the way back to the Old Testament, right? It's in Leviticus. But the hate your enemy is never stated in the Bible anywhere except right here. So when Jesus says, love your neighbor, hate your enemy, is he not referring to the way most people operate? This is the norm. This is the ordinary. If I'm talking about agape love as an extraordinary kind of love, then hating our enemy is just what the ordinary kind of love does. Verse 44, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. This is a level of love that most of us would never aspire to if God had not told us. What do you think? Few of us would not do it if we were not commanded. And then moving on, verses 45 to the end. He says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. You hear that? That sounds like an impossible demand. In order to be children of your heavenly Father, you must love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. I think there's a million sermons in this text here. And one of them has to do with justice. And in where he says that he sends the rain, he lets the sun rise on the evil and on the good. He allows the rain to fall on the righteous and the unrighteous. It's like even God doesn't distinguish between people, but he treats all people the same. And finally, in verse 48, the hardest, maybe one of the most difficult passages. Have you ever got stuck on this one? Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. I hear some laughter. I'm going to guess that some of you have gotten stuck on that one, right? The good news is, perfect in the Bible is not perfect in the way that we typically think of perfect. We think of perfect as being flawless, without blame, and we all know that we've failed on that account. But perfect here is spoken in the context of love, completion, being perfect. And if we had time, I would just point out, everybody knows that famous passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 13? What is that love about? Listen to me, I'm already giving it away. The chapter is about love, right? Agape love. If I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I am only a resounding gong. And he goes on, love is patient, love is kind, blah, 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 right? But then towards the end, what does he say? When I was a child, I thought like a child, I acted like a child, I spoke as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And then he talks about when the perfect has come. And then he says, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. Here we have two passages in the New Testament, Matthew 5, 43 through 48, and 1 Corinthians chapter 13, in which the words love and perfection are put together. What makes us complete? What makes us whole? What makes us perfect in a biblical sense? It is that agape love. It is not just a love for our children, for our spouses, for our significant others. It is not simply a love for people who are like us. It's a love for anybody and everybody. This is the impossible demand. We must try to be like God. Now that effort should not make us feel despair. That effort should not make us feel hopeless, right? Because God himself is loving and forgiving. But like an athlete, what happens when we're trying to beat that time and we don't beat it today? I'm assuming a runner or something, right? What do we do tomorrow? I was thinking for a minute, that was a really hard question, or you just deep in thought? We try again. I don't believe that perfection is something that we achieve on earth, but love is something that we should always be aspiring to, and we fail, but we should never give up. Why should God lay such an impossible demand of love on us? And the answer is, first, because he loved us even when we were his enemies. I have another passage for you. I didn't have Jim read this one so that he could say nice things about me earlier. But this is from Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom now we have received reconciliation. Notice that Paul does mention God's wrath, but he contrasts God's wrath with God's love. God chooses to love his enemies. God demands the same of us. And by the way, love triumphs over wrath, does it not? Doesn't he just say that while we might have been enemies with God, God loved us and he gave himself for us? I would like to end today with an utterly ridiculous statement from left field. Okay? Everybody comfortable? Okay. An utterly ridiculous statement from out of left field, and here it is. Prepare yourselves. It is my observation that with the rise of cable news television, there is an equal and opposite decline in Bible reading. Did that kind of strike you as a thought from left field? Kind of out there? Let me say it again. It is my observation that with the rise of cable news television, there is an equal and opposite decline in Bible reading. Now, I'm going to justify that statement. What do I mean? Our nation is engulfed in divisive issue after divisive issue. We tend to deal with them politically rather than theologically. When people discuss these issues, they tend to view them in terms of binaries such as Republican or Democrat, liberal or conservative, CNN or Fox News. People seem to get lined up on one side or the other. To me, it's like watching WWE. You know, you have like the good guy wrestlers over here and the bad guy wrestlers over here, and they're all yelling at each other, and they're never going to agree. Of course, you know that after the wrestling matches are over, at 3 o'clock in the morning, you'll find them at the Waffle House all eating together because it's an act. But you know that cable news television is all about ratings because ratings gets revenue. And there's no better way to get ad revenue and get people to watch your news channel than to stir up conflict and let it sit. And I find now, every once in a while, I'll preach a sermon that'll put my job in danger. And so I'm going to do that right now and say, I find that church people know more about what's on the news than what's in the scripture. That we have people who don't carry a Bible with them anymore. And I know that sounds a little old-fashioned. You don't necessarily have to. We put it up here for you. There's a stack of Bibles here. But I find that people, when there's an issue, whether it's racism, sexuality, or economy, how we're going to deal with things, that the discussion always sounds like talk radio or cable news and not scripture. And most importantly, what I don't hear is agape. What I don't hear is reconciliation between people who are estranged from one another. I don't hear that I love my neighbor no matter who he or she is. One thing I like to say about the First Christian Church of Atlanta and about the disciples of Christ is that we are a really diverse group of people. Even I've got 19 people in here today. There's two in the back and 17 in here. It is amazing the diversity that we have in this room here. And what is most amazing to me is that we can be politically different. We can be ethnically different. We can be economically different. We can be culturally different. We can be different in any number of ways, and yet what reconciles us and what brings us together is worship. Is the Lord's table. It is the love that Christ has shown to us. What the world thinks is impossible. Is it impossible that we could have people of all different ethnicities in the same building worshiping? Is it impossible that we can have people of different gender identity and sexual orientation in the same place worshiping together? Is it impossible that people with different political views and different socioeconomic statuses cannot be together in the Lord's house? It's not impossible here. Because that standard has been given to us from on high. And though we fail, and though sometimes we fall short of that goal, we get up and we try again. Let us work towards a faith that loves God in God's extraordinary way. Amen. I hope that your Father's Day has been blessed. Let's say a shout out to my dad who is watching the recording on YouTube, and to all of you who are in the building, pray that you will be blessed on this day and that you will be filled with the love of a Heavenly Father who loves you unconditionally and cares more deeply for each of us than any of us could possibly understand. Thank you to all of you who made today's worship a success. Jim Holliday is worship leader. Now you get to see the man who's usually behind the camera. And of course, ably in his place, Jill Chu is running the camera. Our elder, Mike Axon, once again, for being here and for his eloquence and his prayer and for leading us in our time of communion. To our singers, Ed Brucker, Robert Pecorino, and Diane Lanier, joined us today. On the piano, my wife, our music minister, Ann Edmondson, Raymond Rosario, the magic wizard in the booth. And to all of you who are in the Lord's house today, bless you. And for those of you who are with us for the first time, pray that it has been a blessing to you as well. As we leave this place, we go back into a world that is filled with many voices. It is filled with some voices of anger, some voices of hurt. There is a cry for justice. There is a cry for truth. Let us be the hand of God. Let us demonstrate God's agape love for all people. That is the love that will be the balm that will heal many, many wounds. Go into the world shouting through your lives the self-giving love of Jesus Christ, who became poor for our sakes. Through the power of the Spirit and the love of God, may you serve others as though serving Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.